moment. And that's why I feel like I've tried to serve that. Right? There's always a joke. As serious and as sad as the story is, there's always a joke.
Do you think he would approve? And do you think he would have notes?
Oh, he'd absolutely have notes. And no doubt we'd have argued about it and then not spoken for ages because he'd said, why don't you move that to the start and that to the end? But then it won't work. Well, of course it'll work. And we would have then stormed away from each other and gone, maybe we shouldn't work together. So that's why we never really did work together in that way.
Can I ask you about how it is for you on stage? Because you're a performer and you have a routine, which you work very hard on, and you go and do that. But this is personal in a very different way, I'm assuming, than what you've done before. I know you talk about your kids. This feels different, and you're trying to make... You're there to entertain people, inform, entertain. I'm not sure how you'd phrase it. But how difficult is that for you?
When I first started doing the show, I thought I had made a terrible mistake, basically, because it was just too difficult. And I was... When I was doing work-in-progress shows at Soho Theatre and Museum of Comedy, I was genuinely, you know, I was crying on stage. And I was thinking, I don't know if I can... Because I booked to do the Edinburgh Fringe for 21 nights and booked to do a tour for a long time. I don't know if I can do this.
When you say you were crying, so did you have an audience in front
of you? Yeah, in front of you. Oh, yeah. Like, because I'm sharing stuff that I've barely spoken about,
and
you know,
like
at all.
And these are like tester shows, almost.
Yeah, yeah, work in progress
shows. How did the audience react?
You know, again, there was a joke coming, so it was all right. It's like... It's not unheard of to have serious things in a comedy show. I mean, you watch an episode of MASH, watch an episode of Scrubs. I mean, even, you know, Blackadder, famously, you know, you can add serious things into comedy. So it's not unheard of. I just found it when I was first doing it, it was just, I thought it was going to be too difficult. And then the more I did it, you know, by the sort of second, third night of the Edinburgh Fringe, I was really starting to quite enjoy it. And then it's, you know, people are coming along, hundreds of people every night who never knew who Paul was. And they leave the room knowing who he was, and that's really gratifying.
What about reaction? Have people sort of spoken to you about... Because you doing that on stage, I would imagine anyone who suffered loss, and there would be plenty of people in any audience any time, it could well have quite a big impact on them too.
Yeah, the feedback has been very strong, and sometimes people come up and they sort of say, I'm gonna call my sister tomorrow, or I'm going to call my dad, because we haven't spoken. And that's very nice. And then you get... I had one guy come up to me after the show with his wife at the Edinburgh Fringe who'd lost his brother in 2021 to COVID. And he said, in front of his wife, he said, having watched that show, I now feel that my wife understands better what I've been going through than I've been able to communicate. You know, I feel like she understands me now having seen that show. And his wife just looked at me and just nodded, and I was like, wow, that's a lot to take on.
That is a lot to take on. And so were you one of those people who had struggled to talk about it, and then, lo and behold, you were kind of able to do it in front of strangers? Is that you?
I mean, I think I always knew I was going to do something about it in the show, but I thought maybe it was just going to be a 10-minute bit amongst a bigger show that was going to talk about other stuff, talk about the concept of tragedy plus time equaling humour. But as I started, it just took over the whole show, and I just found that once I started talking about it, there was... Because it's a weird thing about death. There's a lot of funny stuff just surrounds it. A lot of stuff just happens that is quite funny. I remember going to my auntie's funeral, and as the hearse rolled in, we all started crying. And then as it got closer, we looked at him and went, who are those people in that hearse? We realised it wasn't our auntie. It was a different funeral that was happening in the crematorium next door. Okay. And they're all looking at us going, who are these people crying at our deceased person? You know, and then we all started laughing because just... It's weird about death. It's just funny stuff just pops up.
How have friends of Paul reacted?
Oh, yeah. I think one of the nicest comments I've had about the show was, again, at the Edinburgh Fringe, somebody came up to me afterwards and said it was like getting to spend another hour with him. And that was, again, that was a really nice thing to hear. Because I think, there's a lot... There's stuff in it when I talk about, like, an argument that we had and things we said, and I talk about funny things he had said about his own health and stuff like that. So, you know, I hope I'm doing him a service, as it were. You know?
I read through some of the comments about your brother from your fellow comedians and people. I mean, he was really respected, wasn't he? There was, and not respecting, it's like, does it been unjust? They said he was super funny, that he was just a great talent to be around and inspiring.
And also people referred to him like almost like he was a therapist, you know, because in the process of directing shows and helping people write their comedy shows, like I say, he would talk. He would get into the heart of anything that was bothering them, trauma that had happened to them, you know, any terrible thing in their past, and he would drag it out of them and help them find a way to make it funny, and that was kind of his thing. So as I say to the audience in the show, I say, you know, he would absolutely want me to turn his death into a comedy show. So if you don't laugh at this, you're the ones disrespecting the dead. So that's the emotional blackmail I hit the audience with early doors.
Did you two ever try to out-funny each other?
Only in a nice way. Like, when comedians and people in the industry are together, we do have a tendency to just try and top each other. And someone will say something funny and someone else will come up with another line. And by the end of it, you've got five minutes. And then what? The only problem is everybody's sitting there going, right, who gets that? Who gets to use that stuff that we just come up with together?
All this comedy gold that you can't waste.
It's lovely to see you here this morning. Yeah. Thank you so much.
The
tour sounds, you know, really interesting and very different for all those reasons. Nice to see you here. Thank you very much. Ed's show is called Tragedy Plus Time. It's currently touring. That needs finishing, doesn't it? Tragedy Plus Time equals...
Yes, well, Tragedy Plus Time equals comedy. That's the idea.
There you go.